constantly being joined by more viewers. Okay. So we are live now. First of all, on behalf of Collective, I'd like to welcome everyone who's attended today's session on the Budget 2021 with Professor Rajesh Bhattacharya. This discussion comes at a time when India is suffering one of the worst economic crises in recent history, particularly with its marginalized sections having suffered the worst. During the COVID-19 lockdown, we have seen the effect of the pandemic affecting different sections of people differently. We saw the plight of migrant workers who took to the streets and made it to headlines for the first time perhaps in many centuries, and receded from the headlines as quickly. Now we are seeing another historic movement, this time by farmers and farm workers taking to the streets, literally surrounding the city of Delhi with their demands against the three pro-corporate farm bills being brought in by the RSS BJP regime. So the Budget 2021 being brought in by the Modi regime at this time came with a lot of expectation. And as we just saw a few days back, the Economic Survey of 2021-22 also showing that India is now witnessing record levels of unemployment, and particularly for students, as student youth of this country, what does the Budget 2021 hold for us? That is a question I think a lot of us already have. So we right now, as we are being joined by more and more viewers, we'll start off with the discussion. The discussion today will be in English. Professor Rajesh Bhattacharya is with the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta. He has been a student of economics, pursuing economics from his undergraduate to his PhD level. Currently, he is with the Public Policy and Development Group at the IIMC. His work has been around the informal economy, particularly how the growth of capitalism in a country like India, which has seen a history of colonialism and continues to struggle with imperialism today. So we can expect a focus on all of these issues in today's presentation. So today's presentation will be for 40 to 45 minutes, followed by a discussion. We already have a list of questions. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Professor Rajesh Bhattacharya to take the stage.
Thank you, Sergio, for the introduction. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Am I coming to clear?
Yeah.
First of all, I'm very happy
to discuss these issues with so many of you. I see almost 75-76 of you are here. So I'm very happy to also know of your thoughts. And that's why when Shambhavi approached me and Shojo also talked to me, I told them that, you know, I would keep my presentation short so that we can have more discussions, pointed questions over which we can go over in discussions. Now, having said that, let me first start with a disclaimer, which is that, you know, budget is not an easy thing to discuss, because if you look at the document and if you want to look at the vision behind the budget, which is there in the economic survey, these are very long, dense documents with lots of data thrown around haphazardly. For example, just to give an example, I was trying to find out, you know, which ministry, under which ministry the allocations have increased or decreased. But I found that there's no particular order in which the ministries are appearing in the table. So it's very difficult to find out an in a ministry. You have to really go through the entire list. So all of this actually make the budget not so easy to decipher. And the first reactions on the day itself may not always be the correct impression. And in fact, I'm very happy. I'm grateful to Shambhavi. Because when she asked me whether it's 1st February or 2nd February, which date I would prefer, I requested her that if it is possible to have it today, because at least all of us would have a chance to have a more informed opinion of what actually happened with the budget, even though it's not going to be clear even today, because there are several things that were announced about which details were not yet provided, so we can't really get the full picture. But even then, there is some more clarity now compared to yesterday. So I'm very happy that it's happening today. I'm not going to throw at you a lot of data and figures because, if you quickly scan the newspapers, type education or health or agriculture, you will find some article which sort of summarizes the main highlights of the budget. There are for and against views, which also, you can find it within 5 minutes. We will discuss in which direction the budget points to, but I'm not going to be very particular with exact figures. Rather, I think what is more important this year is to, first of all, develop an understanding of this budget. Where is it coming from? What is it trying to do? Because this is not a normal year. A budget every year is a big deal. There's a lot of attention to it, a lot of debate on it. Essentially, it is an expenditure receipt statement, right? At the beginning of the year, the government presents the financial statement of the previous year and then announces the allocations for this year. Now, on a smaller scale, you may have seen this at many levels. For example, even a small organization or small club or small association, they also have to do this budgeting, right? So it's you scale it up and it becomes much more complicated, of course. But essentially, that is what it is: an expenditure receipt statement, a revenue expenditure statement, right? However, in India, it has not always been a simple matter of finding out which sector got how much allocation. Oftentimes, there are implicit in the budget or explicit in the budget certain policy directions. So major focus, shifts in focus or major changes in policy, sometimes these are hidden in the budget. So understandably, budget leads to a lot of expectations and debate. But this year, it is even more important to understand this point, that this budget comes in the wake of several announcements made by the central government during this entire last year after the COVID pandemic hit us, right? So periodically, you may have seen several times the government announced packages, changed policies radically. It's not just farmers' bills. If you go back a few months earlier, there were labor law reforms, privatization, and so on, right? So it comes in the wake of a series of announcements, and with it, some budgetary allocations which are already there. Now, this, and the finance minister herself said in the budget speech, that you have to see this as a culmination of several mini budgets that were presented in the last year. So partially, it is more difficult this year to understand what's going on, is also because we have to understand how much of it is already part of what was announced before, and how much it is, how much of it is just announced in this budget speech. More importantly, policy reforms and budget are not the same thing. But this year's budget, and that is what I will try to frame the discussion by more than a simple allocation of funds. It also perhaps signifies a major policy shift, one of the most important policy shifts perhaps since the economic reforms of 1991. Perhaps that is one way to understand. So on the one hand, the budget, as the finance minister herself, is coming at a very strange time. It's unprecedented. It's coming in a once in a century, kind of in the wake of once in a century pandemic and so on. On the other hand, the pandemic has also created a context where something very different, perhaps completely unrelated to the pandemic, was unfolding in India. So rhetorically, it may be presented as a budget in the wake of the pandemic, but if you look closely, it has also to do with a lot of stuff that has no connection with the pandemic. So it is this peculiar conjuncture to understand the budget. Now, before I give you the general idea, I must say that, I am slightly, I'm very happy that you've got already got some questions, but I'm also a little worried. Worried because, I don't know all the figures. I mean, it's quite difficult to, from those lengthy documents, I may not be able to answer all your questions, but I'll be happy to discuss it. Also, it covers almost all sectors. So maybe for all questions, I may not have a ready answer, but I'll be happy to exchange views. Okay, what was happening before this budget? Two things were happening. One of these was unexpected, which is the pandemic, which is not a national issue, though all countries had to nationally respond to it. It's not a national issue, it's a global issue, okay? That, of course, is a rare event, doesn't happen regularly. It is something that you cannot have anticipated and therefore made provisions for or taken measures for. The other is fairly well known, and which is the economy going downward continuously in the 3 years at least before the pandemic hit us. Now, remember that economy might be a very abstract idea, but when you're talking of a slow economy, we'll have to look at exactly what is happening. And I think some of this Shoji already mentioned, but we know that unemployment is, according to the data published by the Periodic Labor Force Survey, is possibly at a 45-year-old high, though according to the ministry, the data is not comparable to previous statistics. It's a new methodology and so on. But all things point to a worsening situation. Even if it is not 45-year high, it's a 30-year high, doesn't matter. The situation is worsening, has been worsening for some time. In fact, it has been worsening perhaps since 2010, because when globally the financial crisis hit, in that immediate year, India may not have felt the full impact, but over the next 1-2 years, it started feeling the impact. And I think the years of high growth, that is the first decade of this century, was more or less over by 2010. After that, as you know, there was revision in the data, and therefore the picture gets complicated. You do not know how to compare, let's say, post 2010 economic data with the previous pre-2010 data. So it gets a bit uncertain, and there are many people who have written about it. But I think if you look at other indicators, then the picture, I think, is quite clear that even before 2016-17, according to currently available data, the slide started after 2016-17 financial year. So we have had about 3-4 years, but even and particularly, after demonetization, as an impact of demonetization. Though in that particular year, it doesn't show. It's strange that in the year of demonetization, India recorded its highest growth rate in the last 10 years, which is sort of, one has justifiably some entitled to some skepticism about that data. And that's where I think I will come to talk about the informal sector and how it remains invisible in the data, and therefore it can give, these official statistics can give very erroneous pictures. But at least official data shows that after 2016-17, the growth rate has been falling. More importantly, unemployment has been going up. in the 8 quarters before the pandemic hit us, the growth rate has been continuously falling. So it's clear. It's there is no doubt about it. There was a lot of discussion already before the pandemic hit that India is moving towards a very different trajectory compared to what we were told we are going to be at the beginning of this decade, last decade. Compounding this picture is the fact that there are several government reports that were leaked but were not published by the government. So it came to the media, people accessed it, and there was some data that showed that perhaps in the last 40 years, for the first time, consumer expenditure, per capita monthly consumer expenditure, has fallen compared to the previous norm. Now, I'll just take 1 minute to explain what it is. In India, we don't have income data. So we do not collect household income data. What we collect is household consumption expenditure data. The survey does this exercise. They do it on all India basis, and they calculate this per capita monthly consumer consumption expenditure, which is sort of a proxy for the income. It is not an exact thing, but it is a proxy. In fact, all the analysis on Indian data regarding poverty, income distribution, 50 years is based on this data. Okay? Now, this report came out in 2017-18. However, it was the government did not, in its draft version, it didn't come out actually. Its draft version was leaked to the media. That is how the media reported it. And on that basis, people, came to certain conclusions. The government said at that time that, there are some problems with the survey. So the report was not officially published. So there is that. So what does it mean? In any economy, particularly in the context of a developing country. And remember that India still has the largest number of poor people in the world. Normal expectation is that at least people's income should be increasing over time, right? So if 2011-12, you see that a household is spending 100 rupees per month, per head, per capita, then at least 2017-18, one should expect the household to be spending more than 100 rupees per capita per month, right? On real terms, I'm not talking of nominal terms, after adjusting for inflation, right? Because that shows an increase, an improvement, however small or large, that shows a certain improvement in the standard of living, economic condition of the people. Now, this decline in real terms, again, by real terms, I mean minus inflation, right? So you take the actual increase in money terms and then you subtract inflation. So that gives you the increase in real terms. This decline in real terms is one of the perhaps most critical findings, if it is true. Again, I don't have access to that leaked report. But if that is true, this is one of the most significant findings in the last 40 years. Right? Because it's not supposed to happen in an economy which is growing at roughly 5-6% for 30-40 years. Should not have people whose incomes, as measured by the consumption expenditure as a proxy, should not have that decline. So again, these are contested data, not official data. So, but if it is true that the unemployment is rising, if it is true that the economy is slowing, and if it is true that consumption expenditure, it's quite possible that the consumption expenditure might fall, right? So, That is a possibility. Now, add to it some other things. For example, the slowdown in private investment. Why should there be a slowdown in private investment? It has been happening for quite some time. All economists who have been observing the Indian economy have been commenting on it. One reason is, of course, the demand. In fact, the main reason is the demand is low, right? Why is the demand low? One thing could be that the external demand coming from other countries, that is low. The world is growing slowly. Global economy is growing slowly. There's not much demand for Indian products. That is one thing. But there's also domestic demand. So, and remember that it's not that India was exporting a huge amount, right? India was never very successful in exports. So it cannot be only an export-driven slowdown in private investment. There must be a component of decline in domestic demand. It will decline if people have less money, that is less income. Private investment is slowing. As you know, are in big trouble. Their non-performing assets, their bad loans have been increasing over time. And, there are many people who are afraid that this year is going to be the critical year for the banks, whether the banks would be able to, tide over the problems this year. So if you combine all of this, private investment, non-performing assets of banks growing, the lack of appetite for credit. I mean, you want to give credit to businesses, they don't want the credit, right? There's not enough demand for the credit, right? If you combine all of this, then the picture is quite clear that India was moving towards a sustained phase, a worrying phase of slowdown in growth with major implications for the welfare of the working people, right? Remember just one data that I want to give you, that about more than 80% of India's workforce, working population, works in the so-called unorganized sector or informal sector. 80%. That includes agriculture. All of agriculture is considered unorganized. But even outside agriculture, the majority of the workers work in unorganized sector. Now, what has been happening is that whatever data we have in the last decade, it appears that the organized sector employment is growing. Now, what is organized sector? It's very simple. Public sector plus large private sector. Not small businesses, large private sector, right? That is the formal sector of the organized sector. This combined is they together form the organized sector. Now, organized sector's employment has increased. And there has been a decline in the unorganized sector's employment. But this aggregate picture is a bit confusing. Because what is happening is that within the organized sector, the type of employment that is being created is more and more of the informal type. That is, it's not your permanent or semi-permanent or regular salaried job with employment benefits, welfare measures, protection, labor law protections, all of that, formal contracts and so on. More and more, the kind of employment is what is being called informal employment. And informal employment not only takes place in the informal sector, it can also take place and is increasingly taking place within the formal sector. So that is why at the turn of the century, an entirely new statistical methodology had to be developed to understand the dynamics of employment, right? Now in India, what is happening is that more and more of the employment created in the so-called formal sector, and that is the sector whose jobs are what we want, average person would want, because that brings it with it decent pay, security, basic welfare provision, and so on. Now, that part of the job within the organization is decreasing. If you combine informal employment within the formal sector with employment in the informal sector, let's not confuse the two. First of all, there are two sectors, informal and formal. If you combine the employment in the informal sector with the informal employment within the formal sector, it comes to about 92% of the labor force. Now, this is again official data. It's not something that, it's fairly well known. It's widely used in the official statistics and research. This part of the economy, particularly the informal sector, is not captured in the annual GDP figures. I'm trying to stress this point because it's very important. An economic census is done every 7 years when they are all surveyed. After that, what happens is that once you've got the benchmark for that year from the census, then for the next 6 years, what happens is that you apply the growth rate of the formal sector to the informal sector. Okay? So, you understand what I'm trying to say? So, essentially, you don't measure the informal sector in the intervening period. You apply, assume that if the formal sector is growing at 5%, the informal sector is also growing at 5%. So, you attribute that 5% growth rate to the informal sector. And that's how you arrive at the annual GDP figures. Now, if you look at what has been happening the last 3-4 years, first of all, demonetization. Which sector would be hurt most? Needless to say, the sector that is cash dependent, that is not mainly driving on digital technology and so on. And that is the informal sector. Everything is cash transaction there, right? Secondly, GST rollout was much more expensive and costly and time-consuming for small businesses. So they were out more. And third, the lockdown. I could teach from home. I'm working on a formal sector organization, and therefore it is possible for me. Of course, the students have been facing problem. Sometimes we also face, but we could manage to do it online, right? Now, not all kinds of activities can be done that. And particularly if you think of the myriad unorganized sector workers, whether it's your small tea stall, small hotel, transportation, tourism, you go to any tourist place, you find so many small shops around which sell local crafts or snacks or whatever. Think about this enormous a range of activities that goes around. Which all of which belong to the unorganized sector. There is no way they can convert it to a digital mode. So most of these activities basically came to a screeching halt with the lockdown. Okay? Small businesses hurt. MSMEs, medium and small scale industries, were hurt more. People lost their jobs. People went back. That's the tragedy of the migrant laborers walking back and so on. Those who went back survived on the ration and the Mangrega work for a year. Some of them, of course, have come back to the cities where they worked before, but many people are still staying back because the entire economy has not come back to normal. The earlier levels of production has not revived. So the impact on the informal sector of all these last 3 years different policy changes has been enormous, none of which is captured in the official statistics. Okay? Therefore, whatever growth figures we see are probably overstated. Growth rates could be even lower than that and so on. So this is the context in which the budget came this year, right? Going to spend a lot of time on the health crisis because throughout the whole year there has been a lot of discussion on how to handle the crisis, what the government could do or did, and so on. So I'm not going to specifically focus on the health crisis as such, but this is the context in which the government has to respond. And governments in different countries responded in different ways, but more or less the idea was that, just throw out all your normal concerns. Annual, in a normal year, you have some certain concerns about the macroeconomy, about the fiscal budget, all of that. The consensus was to throw it out. This year is not for normal economics or normal economic policy. The government has to be there as the main, the central, the critical player to move the economy out of this mess. That is one. Second, people need immediate relief. People have lost their jobs, their incomes, their ability to buy necessities. They need immediate relief. It's an emergency. So the government has two key roles. One is to respond to an emergency. How does the government do it? You can do it in different ways. Mangrega was one solution. Free ration was another way to do it in many countries. Just income was given. A certain amount of income was given to everybody. Okay? And government kept on pumping money into transferring it to their accounts. Because this is an emergency situation. This is the short-term response. A more medium-term response would require the government to pull the economy out of it. Now, many businesses have closed. They are not going, or no, all of them are not going to come back. Many jobs have been lost. And there are many findings that once people lose their jobs, not all of them come back. And there are, what do you call discouraged workers or people who just drop out of the labor market and so on. So a pandemic like this would leave a scar on the economy. And therefore, how to pull the economy out of it? Conventional economic understanding would say that you can't depend on the private sector to pull this economy out in this juncture, because the demand is already low. The private sector, each of them is only thinking about every private company is thinking about only itself, right? So they don't have a macro picture. It's the government which can have a macro picture. Each firm, each company is only thinking about its own investment and profits and so on. And therefore, they will be scared. They'll be hesitant. They will be not willing to take the risks because the market is down, consumer sentiment is low, and so on, the usual thing. Therefore, you cannot expect, it normally does not work. Therefore, essentially, you have to have the government pull the economy out. So even a country which essentially prioritizes or privileges the private sector like United States of America under Donald Trump essentially pumped government stimulus package that was 15% of the GDP. 15% of the GDP, which is historically the highest in US, never happened, right? So essentially this is common knowledge. Now, when you come to India, we already had a slowdown. On top of it, the lockdown and other social distancing measures and everything meant that people are not going out, people are not spending and so on. So in general, there's a slum. So it, in a sense, it pushed the economy into an abyss. And therefore, the government had two major roles. One is the number of poor people, the number of vulnerable people. Remember 92% in the informal economy, which means that, one day you have a livelihood, next day you don't. Because even in a formal sector, the first people who lose their jobs would be casual laborers and others. And that's your informal labor. So 92% is the vulnerable section of the labor force, right? So in a country like India with already slowing economy and 92% labor force, which can be characterized as vulnerable, requires not only government support, but on a larger scale. Okay? There is no way out, and there is nothing to discuss about this. Right? In fact, you rarely find economists agreeing on anything. But in this case, if you look at the arguments, whether you ideologically label one economist as left, another as right, another as centrist, more or less barring a few, almost everybody agreed what needs to be done. I have never seen such consensus before in case of any reforms, policy or budget. In fact, business associations, chambers of commerce, business associations, they have been asking, right? They also agree. So that was the expectation. What was the expectation? Which is that right now, money has to be spent. This is not the time to think about fiscal deficit. There's a high probability that the economy would really get lost in the abyss. You know, it will take years to bring back, right? And if you think about the deficit now, remember, if the economy keeps going down, the deficit will grow higher and higher, because government's earning also depends on the state of the economy. So you got to spend your way out of this crisis. So very simple thing. First of all, let's get one of the arguments away, out of the picture, which is that this is not the year to think of fiscal deficit. If the economy comes back, that can be tackled later on, when the economy is more or less, has found its own momentum. So no considerations, all right, should constrain the government in its expenditure. Secondly, expenditure. Government has to spend. You can't depend on the private sector for doing that. How it happens? The private sector in a slump does not find the that kind of incentive or encouragement, or is not so optimistic. They're usually pessimistic about the future. Normally, it is not going to be forthcoming. So you have to go, government has to spend. How should it spend? Again, very clear. If you have to address two problems with one instrument, because government doesn't have infinite amount of money at its disposal. If you have to address both objectives, then first of all, the relief money, the money that you are going to spend for relief, okay, must also create some sort of, must also reach the majority of the people at the lower ends of the income distribution. The money cannot be spent in a way which goes to only a small section of the upper end of the income income distribution. And the reason is the people who are the lower income class, lower middle income class, they are the most crisis hit at this point. They have a problem of not having adequate income. If money goes to them, they will be spending more and more of it. If money goes to the people at the upper end of the income stream, then they already have money. They are not going to spend all of it. They're probably going to just save, right, in some safe assets. So when you want to boost demand, you must channelize your income, additional purchasing power to those who most need it. And you know that those people are going to spend it, right? They are in need of money. So you got to undertake those projects that put money in the hands of the poor people, people who most need it, by creating some kind of employment in public works or health sector, both in rural and urban areas, because a large segment of the rural population also combines urban livelihoods with agricultural work. It's not that they only do farm work. They also go and work in the small towns or cities for part of the year. So both in urban and rural areas, that employment has to be created. Money has to be put in the hands of the people. That would create local demand. That would bring back the small businesses, including the unorganized sector businesses. That will actually create employment. without that, that's where most of the employment is generated in any case. So without boosting the small scale sector, the MSMEs, the unorganized sector, it's not going to work. So this is plain and simple. Unfortunately, while I find that there was a lot of many people have written about it in the before the budget did not meet my expectations when it came to this particular frame of thinking. What was being done over the last 1 year, if you look at it, were a series of reforms which were pending since 1991. 1991 was a big year as far as reforms, economic reforms were concerned, market-friendly, privatization, liberalization, also all of these were globalization. Those were the big words that were used at that time. Certain sectors were not so easy to implement the reforms. One of them was agriculture. That is one of the sectors where the reforms for the last about 30 years was politically difficult to implement because of resistance by other opposition parties or farmers' organizations, so on. That is one. Again, this is common knowledge, nothing new. I'm just trying to make the connections. Many, many people have written about it. Second is labor law reforms. A perennial debate whether India cannot create good jobs because the labor laws are very strict, or whether the labor laws are justified because India doesn't have enough good jobs. So it's which way should the explanation causality run? But there has been a persistent demand to dilute the labor laws to make it easy. Make the labor market more flexible. Periodically, there have been some attempts at the central level or the state level, but I think in the last year, some major pushes were made in changing labor laws, including increasing the number of hours and so on and so forth. Which is sort of strange because the flight of the migrant laborers already pointed to the almost marginal position of the labor laws in any case. Because if the labor laws were there, they probably would not have needed to, walk back 1,000 kilometers, right? But in any case, each of these would require a lot of time for discussion. But labor laws was one thing. Agriculture was another thing. Privatization was another thing. Despite India having a department for disinvestment, privatization actually didn't happen that much. If you just look at over the years, every year the government announces targets, but it never finally achieves it. And on many cases, there has been pushback to privatization drive. Land is the fourth issue, but land is, of course, has been being a point of contention since 2013, new land acquisition law and so on. So I'm keeping aside land for the moment, but agriculture, labor, privatization. These are the areas where the reforms were facing political obstacles in our system. And this was difficult to implement. This is exactly what was done, including some FDI relaxation, foreign companies and so on. But this was, there were many other things, but these are the principal components. These were pushed through in the last 1 year during the pandemic. Now, so it is actually, if you look at the government's response in case of India, it would appear that the government is not responding to the current situation, the pandemic. The government was trying to complete an unfinished agenda of reforms that has been pending since 1991. So you have this peculiar situation where, the government did increase the allocation for Mangrega last year and the Free Nation, etc. but those were not enough and adequate, right? That was some relief. One would not rule that out, but you know, government could have, for example, increased the number of days from Mangrega to 150 days. Increase the wage rate of Mangrega and so on, right? All of these things could have been done. Now, the point that I'm trying to say is that so there was something peculiar going on. You have a pandemic, but you have a different line of action from the government. If you now place this year's budget, and we can talk about the particulars of the budget, you'll find that the focus is still on the supply side. It's still looking at the private sector investment to pull up the economy. And that is why, despite some big announcements in health and infrastructure and so on, you will see that there is no clear direction in pushing up, in putting money in people's hands and increasing the demand from bottom up, right? So essentially, it is still an approach that tries to make improve the ease of doing business, as it is called. Relax the restrictions on businesses so as to sort of unleash the animal spirits of the investors and so on. And it is expected that the private sector will be happy with this, and they will be feeling more optimistic about the investment, and they will actually increase the investment. So that is something that is, most economists would be not very confident about. That is the route to recovery. First of all, the global situation is not very good. Every country is going through the pandemic, and every country is facing a slowdown and recession and so on. And therefore, the global demand is not going to go up. The only alternative would have been for boosting the domestic demand. That would have helped private businesses. But if that is not forthcoming, it's very difficult to understand what would prompt the private businesses to produce and invest more. Right? So the main way to look at this budget is to think of it as a continuation. And I think the finance minister was very clear in a statement that one is to see it in a continuation. That I should give her as a very honest statement in basically saying how to look at the budget. And it's mainly still focused on supply side, mainly focused on, I would say, some details are still awaited, but it looks like it's still depending on big infrastructure projects to deliver it. I am not very sure big infrastructure projects would lead to money going to the maximum number of poor people and so on. Another thing I must say at this point, you must have noticed there's a lot of comment there that four poll-bound states, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, West Bengal and Assam, have got almost close to 2 lakh crore investment in roads and metro and so on. Now, I think as residents of these states, people might be happy or might be comparing who got more. I am actually quite dismayed. I'm dismayed because this is a whole country's crisis. And in this year, at least, I think electoral people's needs should have taken precedence over electoral needs. And those 2 lakh crores should have been spent across the country for everyone in a manner that maximum number of poor people across the country got the benefit. So I am not very elated about those investments for West Bengal, being from West Bengal and so on. As far as the health sector is concerned, there's a lot of discussion about the massive increase in health, but I don't know, you may have already read that it's because of clubbing together a lot of items. One big project, a new scheme has been announced, which is Atmanirbhar Health, I forget the name actually, which has a 60,000 crore allocation, but remember it is for the next 6 years. So on an annual basis, it's Swasth Bharat, yeah. It's about 10,000 crores per year. Now, remember one thing, that India is one of the lowest spenders. Public spending on India on health is one of the lowest in the world. In fact, economic survey doesn't hide it. Our neighbors in South Asia spend more. Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, they spend more. The whole object was that, and India, by the way, in terms of access to and quality of healthcare, was ranked 145th among 180 countries, according to the economic survey. Right? That was in 2016. So everybody knows that the public health situation, infrastructure in India is pathetic. So this year, there was an opportunity to radically change it. Now, the economic survey says that the spending should be brought up to at least 2.5 to 3% of GDP. From currently, it's about, roughly 1%, which includes both central and state expenditure, by the way. Now, if you look at the calculations, that is not what's coming through. For example, there is within that huge figure of 2.23 lakh crores for health, remember there is one-time allocation for COVID vaccination, which is about 35,000 crores. There's 60,000 being spent on drinking water and sanitation, which is of course related to health, but it's not an explanation of the health infrastructure per se, right? I'm not saying it's not important, it's good. But I'm just saying that it's not exactly explanation on health sector. And several other things, nutrition and many other things, departments, budgets are, combined together. In effect, the health budget did not receive the kind of boost that we would have expected given the economic survey and the crisis that we have seen. So even on the health crisis front, the budget fell short of the expectations. And as far as the immediate relief is concerned, so I've talked about two things now. One is the economy recovery. And I said that this whole approach of private investment-driven recovery is something that does not convince me for various reasons. And I see no effort in this budget to do what many people believe should be done, which many countries are doing. That's one thing. Second, I talked about health. So whether this crisis was used as an opportunity to revamp our health infrastructure, and I am not yet fully, we do not have enough details. And definitely the claim that has been made that, there's 137% jump in health budgeting, that it's not entirely correct. And the third point is about immediate relief, right? People are still hurting, people are still scarred from the lockdown and all that. So what measures are there? Now, two things that have been very, very crucial were MGNREGA's budget was last year, of course, increased by a huge amount, had to be 40,000 gross was added to it, but this year it has been brought down. Now, I find it difficult to understand that those people who needed the jobs last year will suddenly find the jobs this year, and therefore they will not need the employment in the 100 days work scheme. That I find thing is a very, not a very justifiable assumption. I find it difficult to imagine that everybody will now no longer need, people no longer need MGNREGA. Even baffling are some of the other things. For example, a direct money transfer scheme like PM Kisan Nidhi, which transferred money to the farmers, the budget has gone down. It's quite difficult to understand compared to last year. Now, we all know that currently, I think about 9 crore farmers who are benefiting from that. And I think the number that is going around is about 14 to 15 crores can potentially benefit from it. So there are still about 4 or 5 crores farmers left. And some of the states have not accepted the scheme. West Bengal, for example, and they finally accepted it some time ago. So there are 72 lakh farmers in West Bengal who might not apply for it, right? The point is that why would the budgetary allocation go down, right? So there are when I think about the rural economy, I'm thinking about agriculture. I'm thinking about Mangrega. I'm also thinking about small towns and, you know, job opportunities. And many people wanted an urban employment generation scheme. Many people advocated for it because that is very important. I can give you one statistics from West Bengal. You know, more than 50% people are now employed in non-agriculture in West Bengal. Right? So and sometimes they combine both. So a lot of it is in urban areas and so on. They might not get back their jobs that they had as migrant labor in other states because those economic activities might not be revived so quickly. Therefore, there is possibility of creating urban employment, like Mangrega in the rural areas. So all of that was necessary. We should have directly put money in the hands of the people, which have directly created employment. It would have revitalized the small scale sector, the unorganized sector, which I think would have been much more effective in creating demand, which would finally actually, energize the markets. I think that would have been even good for the big businesses because they would see the demand reviving and therefore they would be investing and so on. So I'm baffled by the lack of such push from the government side, and it goes against what the current consensus is and what is being done in many countries of the world. But I can understand, this is my understanding, where it's coming from, which is that the focus has been on completing the reforms that have been pending, using the pandemic as an opportunity, rather than responding to the pandemic. I think that's where the thinking has been going, and that's why the measures to handle the economic situation in the wake of the pandemic has been half-hearted at best, and in some cases almost absent. So I don't see a quick recovery of the economy. I'd be happy if it happens, but I'm a bit worried and a bit skeptical about that. And as far as the vulnerable section, the 92%. Well, I think they are in a big economic problem for some time to come, at least. We do not know how long, but, for some time to come. That is how I broadly understood the budget. I will not stop now. I wanted to speak only for 45 minutes, but I took 10 more minutes, I guess. So I will stop and I will take questions. Thank you.
In the presentation, I think that applies very well for this budget. This budget too is another attempt by the government to use this crisis as an opportunity to push forward long-standing demands, long-standing agendas, which it has consistently been trying to implement for many decades now. First of all, I think on behalf of Collective and all the members in the audience today, I would like to thank Professor for giving us his time. Just to share with the audience, we received two questions earlier from the audience of the Google form that was circulated, very fundamental questions. One person had asked, what is the point of a budget? Why do we have a budget? And someone else had also asked, who checks on whether the promises made in the budget, all the allocations, all the outlays are actually fulfilled or not? From the brilliant context which Professor laid out at the beginning of the presentation, I think we'll all have a better understanding now of where this budget document comes in a series of other documents, including labor law regime changes, privatization being brought in, and a number of other related policy decisions. another, I think, because today's audience also has a number of economics students, one thing of particular interest would probably be the exposition about how more than nine out of 10 Indians are actually not counted in the growth figures. So why measuring growth simply by GDP or simply by consumption data might not actually show the true picture. We've been talking about fake news and Godi media, but in the discipline of economics as well, perhaps we have been far too long neglecting the majority of India's toiling people, which Professor also mentioned in today's discussion. So I think we can now move on to the second part of today's discussion, which includes question and answer. So the floor is now open for questions. Before moving on, just one announcement on behalf of Collectives. The idea for having discussions and exchanges like this on a range of issues which affect the majority of India's working people is for student youth to be actively engaged in these issues, to learn from them and to be able to respond to them. So since we were on the topic of privatization in agriculture and decreasing public investment in agriculture, we are all aware of the nationwide historic movement by farmers and farm workers that's going on and the repression that they are facing at Singhu, Ghazipur, Sikri and other borders and across the country. So in solidarity with the farmers, tomorrow citizens of Delhi have organized Solidarity March, Citizens March from Mandi House to Jantar Mantar beginning at 12 o'clock. On behalf of Collectives, I would like to appeal those listening to today's discussion to please join in if possible with your banners and posters. We will be present with our Collective banners and it would be great to see some of you there. So moving on to question and answer, some questions that we had received earlier, a large number of them were dealing with the question of employment. So maybe we could begin with that. Professor already spoke about the kind of employment that India has had and the paradigm shift we are seeing in terms of privatization. So perhaps some initial comments on what kind of employment generation and in terms of numbers, how many jobs are we talking about that we can expect from this budget. And in the meanwhile, rest of members of the audience are please welcome to put in your questions in the Google Meet.
So, Shoshir, just one thing. You mentioned the couple of questions that you received earlier.
Yeah.
Should I first respond to them?
Sure.
Okay, now very quickly, I think it's very, this question is actually very important, you know, why budget, right? Or who checks whether the allocations are actually, finally implemented? Budget is might appear to be very dry statement of figures, you know, receipt and expenditure and so on. It's not one of those things that in politics, politics is about passion, but you know, budget doesn't appear to be a very passionate exercise. It's more like a very dry exercise. But I think this is not true. Budget is the heart of democracy. It's people's money. How the government is spending, the government is accountable to the people. The government cannot spend one rupee out of what is called the most important component, which is consolidated fund, without the approval of the parliament. And the people have the right to know what did you announce and what did you spend. So eventually it comes out. So it's true that, you know, this year you may look at the allocations and then get some picture. Next year you might find that, you know, that's why you have budget estimates and then revised estimates. And I'm not an expert on budget at all. But, you know, by comparing the figures at the beginning of the year, the end of the year and the final figures, you can find out whether the expenditure has been made or not. And the government has to answer in the parliament as to why it did or did not spend what it had promised. So, in short, budget, though a very dry exercise, is very, very much a democratic process. In fact, the question, therefore, is what is the connection between popular aspirations, people's needs, people's demands, and the budget? And that's why often government is questioned or the budgets are criticized. when we criticize budget, what do? We actually say this is what the people needed, and this is what you did. You know, what is the money you are spending? Why are you spending it here? So that's how the criticism comes, right? So it is very important in terms of accountability. There was one question about the growth figures that don't take into account 9 out of 10 people. I'm guessing that was about the size of the informal labor force. Okay, no, what I said is that the growth figures do take into account. It's not that the GDP figures do not include the informal sector. It has to. Because, it employs 80% of the labor force and more than 40%, close to maybe even 50, close to 50% of the total GDP. So, of course, it is taken into account. I'm saying that the way it is taken into account, because it is difficult to actually survey millions and millions of tiny enterprises, what happens is that the census is done in a certain year, and there's a gap before the next round of the census is done. In between, I'm not talking of population census, I'm talking of economic census. That's different exercise. In between those two rounds, so those two rounds give you a good picture. In between those two rounds, either you have some information from the sample surveys, not the whole, the sample surveys, or that can give you some idea. Or what you have to assume is that with the previous round as the benchmark, you have to assume that it is growing at the same rate as the formal sector, and thereby you keep increasing the output of the informal sector by imputing the growth rate of the formal sector to each sector of to the respective sector of the informal sector. But it is not that it is not taken into account, right? But in taking into account everything, no, much of it is not often invisible and remains invisibilized. But that's, yeah, it's not that it doesn't include that. Okay, I think those are the first set of questions that came. Now I think, Shojo, you can tell me how to go about it. What should I? Look, it's not so. I guess immediate benefits of this budget will go to construction and real estate sector because there's a lot of push on the infrastructure, right? If a metro gets built, then the real estate come up, highways, so you can get employment there. What is and I guess whatever increase in expenditure is going to happen in the health sector is going to create additional employment in the healthcare sector, right? So those are sectoral issues. But beyond that, there are certain announcements of which we are not very sure. For example, there's an agriculture infrastructure fund, right? Which was announced even before the budget, 1 lakh crore fund. However, so far it's a commitment and in principle allocation. The allocation I think is very little, 900 crores or something. I guess there's a CESS that has been announced, to petrol, diesel, and so on, which would be go towards this agri infra fund. Now, that could be very important if it is at the local level. Then some rural employment will be created. But again, since there are no details, it's difficult to actually talk about what exactly. Again, this new Swasth Bharat scheme, it should be revamping primary, secondary, tertiary healthcare. So if that is the case, there will be definitely some employment in the sector in rural areas too. Beyond this, there is no explicit focus on employment. And, I'm not sure how much this amount, whether this amount is enough. This 60,000 crores spread over 6 years and, 1 lakh crore for agricultural infrastructure, agriculture in such a vast area. I'm not very sure even if we combine them, how much of employment will it create? And specifically when there has not been any increase in the outlay of Mangrega, and especially in terms of a number of days or at least the wages and so on. And specifically since there is no urban employment guarantee kind of scheme, not very sure how much of an employment boost would happen specifically as a result of the budget. So again, as I said, I think the assumption is that the private sector investment would revive and that would drive employment growth, which I am not very sure about. I don't see why private sector would be able to do that impossible job. I mean, it's a government's job actually at this point of time. I'm actually quite worried about employment.
Tough questions. We have three questions which have come in related to different sectors of the economy. P. Soumya asks about how does the budget address the problems of farmers and agricultural growth? So I think we already discussed some of it in the presentation, but
yeah,
more about the agricultural sector. The next two questions by Gunjan and Dharmendra relate to the startup ecosystem and the IT and telecom sector. So how has the budget looked at these two perhaps related sectors? And lastly, a question from Nishtha, who asks, yep. Can we say that unemployment often leads to a fall in consumer demand? And is it correct to relate the rise of unemployment with the loss of bargaining power of the labor unions, which forces them to accept lower wages, thus reducing their consumption? So perhaps these three questions will be taken.
So at the outset, I had said that I do not know about all the sectors. I'm not sure I'll be able to talk about the fintech hub in a gift city. I do not know. There is some fintech hub in Kolkata about which we hear things, but we do not know whether it's actually what the government is claiming is exactly what is happening. So I do not know actually. The startup ecosystem is a lot of, in particular in certain centers of India, is quite vibrant. It's definitely going to. This pandemic has also created opportunities for new kinds of work, new kinds of products and services, right, which we did not think about earlier. So some of these could be new avenues for startups to emerge and scale up. On the whole, I have no clear idea where the budget pushing the startup ecosystem. I think there is already some policy level thing. I'm not sure the budget has done, actually talked about it. And the details, I do not know. I'm sorry about that. I can't say more. Similarly for IT and telecom sector, you have to, forgive me, I do not know. But one thing is that IT and telecom sector is quite a matured thing. Telecom sector is, of course, going through a lot of, convulsions because of disruptions and in business disruptions and market competition. So the picture is still unclear. But, they are matured, the private sector. So probably, you don't need to focus on them, as much as, other sectors. The government has to prioritize. So, but I do not know in details. How does the budget address problems farmers and agricultural growth? It doesn't, I think, directly. I think that, and it's not just this budget. I'm not sure which budget in the last 20 years has actually explicitly addressed the problems of farmers and agricultural growth. And I can tell you the politics behind this, which is simply that the farmers, though there is the majority of the labor force is still in agriculture now contributes a very small percentage of the total GDP, right? About 15%, right? And therefore, in terms of its importance, agriculture has been, its importance has been going down for about 4 or 5 decades now. I think the solution lies outside agriculture. That is the idea. Indian agriculture already has very low, not so good yields, and particularly in many crops, very low yields. Farmer incomes are abysmal. And I don't think I have seen in a major attempt to address the problems of farmers and agricultural growth, except for loan waivers, which you find from time to time in different states. Except for that, I am not very sure that there has been any major, major ways that the budgets have addressed the problems of farmers in the last 20 years. And this year's budget also does not do it. Again, I mean, there's the three farmers' laws that could be a game changer, at least in some states. In some states, farmers have already been selling outside the mandis, but in some states, good number of farmers selling quite a significant portion in the mandis and so on. So, yeah, potentially this can majorly change the agrarian economy to greater or lower, lesser extent. I think that is the approach in this budget. Agriculture reforms is the approach in the budget too. That's why you do not have any clear proposal to address farmers, because the proposal is the liberalization of agriculture, right? To develop the markets. That is the approach, which has already been taken before through the three farmers laws. And essentially, when the agricultural infra fund is going to be just a support system for the mandis, mostly what we have seen, support system for mandis to keep them going, because their role will not end, but some sort of support system, it looks. It's not clear, but that's it. There is no new, nothing specifically related to agriculture. I hope you got the answer. And in fact, that's why I say that, how do you understand the budget? You have to understand it in the context of the very important reforms that have been announced throughout the last year during the pandemic. So agriculture, you have to read it in that sense. Anishita, unemployment definitely leads to a fall in consumer demand. Unemployment is one of the instruments of disciplining, has always been an instrument of disciplining labor force, because essentially by having a pool of labor precariously employed or unemployed, makes the workers, already employed workers, worried about what would happen if they ask too much from the management. So this is very well known. And so it has often been used as an direct or indirect instrument for disciplining labor or keeping the wages low. And yes, that definitely has an effect on the consumption. Workers' wages are a cost to the company, but it's also a demand for the company. So for the entire industry, right? So it's a double-edged thing. It's not that, by paying the workers less, you do not necessarily make it better for the industry as a whole, because your demand also goes down, right? So it's not always good to, even for the business point of view, to pay workers very little wages. Okay. I think I can take this question about the Amir.
Everyone who's joining on Facebook, maybe we could read out the other questions that have come in.
Okay.
And, so two more questions have come in the chat box. One is from Khushi, who asks that the budget mentions that there has been a reduction in health and social policy sectors. Many analysts have pointed out that in fact there has been a reduction in social services and the healthcare fund. You yourself mentioned some discrepancies in how the health allocation amount has been reached. So your comments on that, particularly on social security and welfare scheme. And the other question from Vadipu Amit, who asks, so you had mentioned that creating local demand will boost economy, and then the allocation of the budget can be, in that case, the allocation of the budget can be decentralized. So since we are talking of the budget as a democratic exercise, how do you look at the question of centralization and decentralization, particularly in the last few years since we have had so many debates about the GST and further centralization of taxation? So maybe these two questions can be taken at once.
Yeah, sure. Both excellent questions. Let me start with Khushi's questions first. Yeah, so the budget also has several components where there is a decrease. And I mentioned one thing, right? You know, even in agriculture, there's a decrease in MGNREGA from last year's revised estimates. Not budget estimates, but revised estimates, right? So, but also PM Kisan Nidhi, where the amount is going down. That is a direct cash transfer. Now, in education, I have not talked about it, but if you look at women, and students within the population, these two groups were also affected in a major way for very different reasons. Women being forced to drop out of whatever livelihood options they had, but also subjected to more domestic violence and all that, and additional household chores and so on. So this year has been bad for the women more than the men, right? If you look at students, and there, in fact, the impact is going to be long-lasting, because what does a year of education delivered in, you know, over smartphones? I mean, if you go to the rural, you know, parts, I think you all know that even in urban areas, it has been very patchy, the connection, even in cities, big cities. Students could not log in, some of the students couldn't log in. Beyond that, you know, the teacher is just uploading some lecture, and then the student in class two or three is just reading it and so on. So education suffered in India because of the pandemics. And, you know, it was unavoidable given the situation, one couldn't do much, but it is important. Thus, expenditure on education should increase. It's not that we're spending a lot on education. We're, again, spending very, very little amount on education, public spending on education. And it should have increased. It didn't. Right? And in many other social sector policies, in fact, even in nutrition, if I remember correctly, nutrition, the allocation has gone down. Women and child development allocation has gone down. I think women's empowerment and security, the allocation has gone down. Education gone down. Okay? And some sections of you know, disadvantaged, vulnerable population, explicit allocations for those groups have gone down. So, as I said, you know, there are some areas where the budget has promised a big increase in spending, and some of these are already being actually, you know, people are going through it to find out how much of an increase at all was there, or was there a decrease. Now, I've been trying to work on the data. I still have, you know, it's difficult to find out, you know, which component increased, which component decreased. It's not very easy, but definitely it's not the big push that people expect. Definitely nowhere close to it, even in the health sector, right? And, you know, it might turn out to be a very, very, very moderate increase, if at all, even in the health sector. And so let me then come to Madhavami's question. Yes, I completely agree with you. I think that is how it should be done. It should have been done during the pandemic itself. And not just the provision of ration and, you know, mangrega. There are many ways employment could have been created to address the health pandemic itself. For example, there's a lot of support service, a lot of community support that is needed in addressing any health situation, in particular this pandemic. First of all, there are lots of trust issues which resulted in people being not allowed to enter villages or people being ostracized, even in cities and other people, senior citizens being lonely, suffering from depression, and so on. So there could have been a mobilization of people who are currently unemployed in these jobs, not as frontline health workers, that's a different thing. Just volunteer services, community services, that would have generated employment at that point of time, that would have generated some income, that would have actually addressed both problems, as well as the economic recovery. Anyway, unfortunately, that has not been done to the, even now, I think without local demand, and I've been saying this, that one should not make such a clear distinction between rural and urban now. It's not that, spending on agriculture, spending on mangrega is enough, because many of them, these people also go and work in the, do a second job in the city or small towns, but there are lots of small towns, right? And many of them, have some, an auto rickshaw or something in construction or some shop, commercial establishment or whatever, right? Even textiles, handicrafts, in some of the states, it's a major thing, right? One of the biggest employment sectors is this, handicrafts and handlooms. One often do not realize that it is one of the, in fact, the second biggest after agriculture. So, essentially there are many ways they depend. So you got to have a scheme which addresses both rural and urban areas without thinking of a clear separation. Mangrega, that's why we needed something like mangrega in the urban areas. So that, that strict separation is not there and could find work. So I think that would have led to much more efficient way of creating employment at the local level. And why the local level boost to the economy is important is precisely because of the millions and millions of tiny enterprises, many of them in the unorganized sector, who buy from each other. It's these people who will buy from those unorganized sectors. So if these people at the bottom of the income distribution get money, they will be buying from each other. They're both the suppliers and the demanders, customers in the unorganized sector. And therefore, the more money goes there, the more the local businesses, the small enterprises, small businesses would again come back to life. And that way, I think you can ensure that the maximum people actually gets out of this crisis, right? The problem is that oftentimes, and I think there is this, many people have been commenting on this question, that this budget and in general the approach has been that let there be some big spending and let the big companies invest and the money will trickle down. This trickle down to the lower levels. Now, this trickle down theory has been criticized for over now 50 years. Now, people are idiot or not. There's no way you can convince. It's very difficult to convince someone that, if you believe that that is how the poor benefit through trickle down, then there's no way you can convince otherwise. So the belief is now that, through these expenditures, if you make a lot of highways, then it would, and the real estate and all that, it would actually, or through that, you actually generate demand for steel and metals and other things, big pharmaceutical organizations, through that it will trickle down. First of all, in India, the inequality is rising at an alarming level. It is already at an alarming level. India is one of the most unequal countries in the world. And it happened in just 30 years. So we were actually a very low income inequality country. And now we are at the top. In fact, we are crossing traditionally highly unequal countries, which were in parts of Latin America and parts of Africa. We are almost there. Middle Eastern countries, their inequality is slightly going down or stagnant. Latin America is going down. We are the only country. China's also, but we are much above China. Now, this inequality means that no amount of infrastructure spending, because we have been doing it, you know, highways and ports and all that for the last 20 years, right? That did not put money in the hands of the people, right? Secondly, there is major interstate disparity now. Never after the colonial period has there been this kind of inequality between states. It was there during the British rule. There were only two cities which had most of the industrial and financial capital, Calcutta and Bombay, and then Delhi and Madras at that time. That's it. Now, we are now in a situation where there are certain states which get most of the investment, which gets you know, most of the infrastructure and so on. And I don't think we can assume that a push through the push from the top involving you know, big companies would necessarily lead to inequalization of income. So for the various reasons why the trickle down has not happened in India, one can say that, you know, poverty rate has been going down, which is to be expected in a growing economy. But rising inequality is a big problem, not only from the point of view of social justice. Even if you're only concerned about economic growth and nothing else, rising inequality is a major, major obstacle to higher economic growth. And therefore, I think, you know, there have been lots of work on this, lots of debate on this. There's nothing new I can contribute, but I can only say that this budget, you know, I don't see any recognition of this problem of inequality as a problem, not only for social justice, but also for growth. For all of these reasons, you know, I think that you are absolutely right. It's local level development that is necessary, but I don't see any direction there. And in any case, as Shoujo mentioned, that, you know, federalism is, even this year says on petrol, diesel, alcohol, and some other things, towards agriculture infra fund, that is by actually they have reduced the excess duty. They have increased the cess. So people might not have to pay more, but now it will only go to the center, not to the states. But remember that the states were at the forefront of fighting the pandemic. They had to incur the major expenditure and so on. So my view is that more should have been given to the states and further, you know, to the downwards. But that is not what's happening. Shomi, I think, you know, I think I more or less, you know, addressed your question about poverty, economic needs. I think I have talked about it. So if there's a specific question, ask me. And it's a very big question, right? Women's workforce participation rate has been debated and discussed for over a decade now, that women are not, are not there in the workforce. So where are they going? Is it because there are no opportunities, or is it because their situation has improved and they don't have to necessarily work as in previous years? That's a big debate. Now, women allowed to work night shifts. If you make provisions for that, you should also increase the budget allocation for women's safety and empowerment. I don't see that. So that has been slashed while you are making provisions. So I'm not sure that again, I think at the end, one has to say that I think at the individual level, we are being asked to be Atmanirbhar. So everyone is, basically you have to fend for yourself. That seems to be the message. So you can work night shifts, but there's no government support for towards security of women and so on. So basically you are on your own. That's the seems to be the message. At least it seems to me. Yeah.
Wrap up today's discussion on that note. From what we got from the presentation as well as the question and answers was that I think some fundamental truths that are generally accepted about that things are actually getting better every year and people's lives are improving does not actually bear out when you look at the statistics, when you look at the level of rising inequality and the number of other reports that Professor mentioned during the presentation. So I think one hand we have that reality, and on the other hand also from what was covered during the question answer is that a number of alternatives do exist and have existed for every budget that has come out in the last more than three decades now. Every budget has had a number of other alternatives from which certain alternatives were chosen, which has resulted to this huge increase in inequality, which is not just indefensible from a social justice perspective, but also, as you mentioned, from overall ensuring growth and progress for society. So the rationale given that there is no other alternative to trickle down, and that is the only alternative that you must all accept, I think it's time to firmly reject that neoliberal doctrine, and especially at a time when the market fundamentalists and the religious fundamentalists have joined hands to rule the country. That is a truth that needs repeating several times over. So on behalf of everyone present here, I'd like to thank Professor Bhattacharya for taking time out today to discuss the budget with us. And we look forward to have more such engaged discussions with everyone who could join us today on Google Meet as well as on Facebook who've been watching with their questions and comments. And I think what all of this brings out is that the point of discussion and debate is to be able to intervene in these democratic decision-making processes, which otherwise are just surrounded with big crore trillion dollar figures, or about how the finance minister used a tablet instead of reading from a regular briefcase. But to actually be able to engage more in these processes, which is where how democracy can actually work. Democracy at the workplace, democracy in society, as well as in our politics. So on that note, repeating the familiar slogan that on behalf of Canadians we have always been raising, towards a free university, towards a free society, I'd like to thank all participants in today's discussion for joining us today. And
Professor Bhattacharya?
Yeah.
Sorry, can I ask just a last question if possible? Yesterday,
if professor allows, maybe
if he wants to answer, he can, or you can close. I'll just put forward a point.